So I have various types of topics today, and I'm going to go through them fairly quickly. Less demos this time, more concepts, but all practically usable as soon as you go back. Now, I don't know how many of you are using some kind of Office 365. Oh, that's a big number. All right. Now, Office 365, everything comes to you on platter, except for the mail migration. Everything is pre-configured, pre-integrated, but that doesn't mean on day one it is secure. And it's difficult to really understand exactly what to do to tighten security to the maximum extent without making it inconvenient for the users. So remember this particular site, securescore.office.com. What does it give you? I hope I have it connected. When you go to the secure score, it gives you a score. And it doesn't just give you a score. This total number will change for each one of you because it depends on your configuration, the complexity of what you are doing, and which type of packages you have purchased. And after that, it tells you what is the target score you want to achieve. So you can make it very strict or balanced or something like that. And then it will tell you what is to be done to improve the score. For example, the most obvious, which I'm sure all of you have done, is there has to be multi-factor authentication for all global admins. And the list goes on and on. The length of the list will, of course, depend on your environment. So if you have not done it before, just go there and just do an assessment. And of course, you can monitor that across time if you go to Score Analyzer. And that will give you a chart how it has fluctuated across time versus the average across the board, across different tenants. So that's Secure Score. It's a very single slide, but very, very important for all of you. Now, earlier we had either My Documents or we had server storage for departmental files, but now things have become complex and there are too many options available. So let me give you a very simple guide of what to store where. If it's My Documents related files, obviously the choice is OneDrive. But the mistake being done is if you give 1 TB storage to a user, the user tries to dump everything from My Documents on that 1 TB and it chokes the bandwidth. Then it doesn't serve any purpose because whatever is in My Documents, at least 60% of those files we have never even opened for years. So the correct way of utilizing OneDrive is to store active files first. What is active? If I create a new file, by all means it should go on OneDrive. And any file which I open on an ongoing basis, I'm using it, that means it's active. So that should be migrated to OneDrive. That's a good, simple approach. It doesn't trouble you with the bandwidth and users also happy with it. But before all that, ask yourself a question. How many users have taken a backup recently of their My Documents? Very few, right? In IT, of course, there may be a higher percentage, but at user level, IT is not responsible for their backup. So make sure every user takes backup of the My Documents because we're not intending to put all the files on OneDrive. Now, there may be departmental files and there may be team-related files. We will see them later. Now, all the things we do is some kind of work. I'm talking at a very generic level. So there is two types of work, fast work and slow work. Fast work is done using some kind of instant messaging. In this case, I'm showing you Skype for Business. And slow means everything else. Everything else typically boils down to mail with attachments and something like that. Even if it is OneDrive or SharePoint, there is no instant response coming to you. That's why I'm calling it slow. So this is the slide. Individual OneDrive, departmental on SharePoint based team sites, and teams which may or may not be long term in groups or a specific new thing which is called Teams app. I'll show it to you later. Now coming to fast work, I'm not going to show you everything you can do in Skype for Business. Of course, I don't have time for it, but these are the things I would like to talk about. How many times you have attended Skype meetings and there is noise coming, people are coughing, sneezing, all kinds of disturbance coming? Not the presenter. There may be multiple presenters, there may be multiple users. Do you have disturbance or not? Now sometimes, to make matters worse, the presenter coughs or has some disturbance around him or her. What do you do? That person may be presenting the desktop or a presentation. The Skype window is not in front of you, so you don't have a chance to mute it quickly. If you try to mute it, you'll first try to find the Skype window, Alt-Tab, and that frustrates the audience further. So there is a Windows F4 shortcut which does instant mute, and it's a toggle. So Windows F4 will unmute it as well. So remember that shortcut whenever you're presenting and tell it to all the users as well. Now, another common thing is everyone is not going to join the meeting exactly at the time at which it is scheduled. So some people just join a little later, some heavy discussion is going on and they just barge in. So don't do that. It's a small little thing, but still people don't have the etiquette. We have not even got the etiquette for email after 20 years. So instant communication is very, very far away. So just listen to what is happening. Find a good spot where you want to introduce yourself, interrupt or whatever, and then go in. Till then, be on mute. There's another nice thing called politics. What does that mean? Do you know we can do a poll on Skype for Business? Yes or no? Yeah. So just to show you how that happens, I'm going to go to Skype for Business and chat with someone, and you go to this. Unfortunately, that button is hidden under More, a button which nobody clicks. So when you click on it, you go to poll, and then it allows you to actually do a creation of a poll. You can keep it ready if you really want to do save time of the audience. Now, once you do a poll, you can say, should we take this decision? Yes, no. Should we increase pricing? Yes, no. When there is a large audience and you want to quickly get consensus. So this is what I'm doing here. And possible responses you control. And then you run the poll. So all the audience members will now see the poll instead of the presentation. Now what are they supposed to do? They are supposed to respond. And when they respond, you will see a chart like this. And what does that chart show? A breakup of how many said yes, how many said no, and a percentage. Right now I don't have too many people, so it's 100%, but let's say it is 60-40. 60 yes, 40 no. Now the question is, are the audience members seeing this? Can they see this breakup? By default, no. By default, they can't see it. And there is no naming there. It's anonymous poll. You can never find out who said yes, who said no. So remember that. But if I want to show it, of course I can show it to people by going to poll actions and say results are shown to everyone. And then people will see the results. Of course, you have to give some time depending on the number of people in the audience so that it stabilizes before you change this. So now I just showed you two features. How to do a poll and how to make the results visible. That's a technical piece of knowledge. How do you play politics with it? Think and tell me. So suppose it's a controversial decision. First show just the poll. You get a sense of what is the breakup of what is there in people's minds up front, because they can't see the results yet. Let it stabilize. And then remember the numbers. You can take a screenshot. In fact, there is a way to save that screenshot also here. Then show the results to people and see what change in the breakup. That gives you a quick idea of how many people are on the fringe. There's no other way of finding that out. So even a simple feature can be utilized to our advantage if you know how to manage it with psychology rather than just technology in mind. I've used it multiple times and it works beautifully. Try it out next time. Another simple thing, how to stand out in a chat. If it's a large audience, people keep typing something, questions come, comments come, all kinds of things. And presenter takes a pause periodically to look at the chat and say which questions are worth answering or something like that. That presenter has a very little amount of time to scan the chat. So if the chat is scrolling, how do you stand out in the crowded chat? Any ideas? Any ideas? So that's another simple but effective thing. Go to the chat window. In that area, right click, change font, and then what happens? Don't make it too big, that will be rude. Make it different color and slightly two font size. Default is 10, make it 12, that is enough. There's another nice method. All of you must have noticed at the bottom, there is an exclamation mark. So if you click the exclamation mark and then send the text, it stands out with an exclamation mark. So if I'm a presenter looking at a busy chat, I'm most likely to notice that. Simple things, but make a difference. And long mail trails I'll cover in the email part. Now coming to teamwork. Teamwork happens in all kinds of ways. The most common way some of you may have seen, but I will still show it to you. Suppose I want inputs from multiple people. What do? I get a document And what is the next step? I want inputs from 4 people. I send a CC to all of them. Now there are 5 copies. They reply to me. All the 5 come to me. Now I'm going to copy paste, and then create a 6th document. Is the job done? Is it done or not? Not yet, because what sales has written directly came to me, HR and quality and finance and vice versa. They don't know that. So what am I going to do now? This 6th document I'm going to send now. 10, 14, 15, 17, 93. And all this is called teamwork. Do you agree or not? In spite of all the technological changes, advancements, we still work like this by and large, because we are used to it. So there has to be some difference made in the whole thing. Now, I'm covering PowerPoint a little. I'll also show you how I did that animation, because this kind of animation takes a long time to adjust things properly and a lot of effort goes into it. Now, that's how teamwork happens, and obviously that's bad. So now we have 2 different methods of managing teamwork within Office 365. Of course, ad hoc teamwork, me and one more person, that happens on OneDrive. But if it's a team, it can either be a SharePoint site, which we are used to, nothing new there. But there are 2 other aspects called groups or teams. So I'll show you groups first. What are groups? So you just go to Outlook first. Groups can be created in Outlook. So this is your mailbox, and at the bottom you will see something called groups. You right click on it and say new group, which I've already created. But if I go to a new group, what does it ask you? Just a name for the group. And notice it's checking whether that alias is available in your Exchange, an AD, because it's internally going to create a DL for it. So it's checking. And now if it's available, it'll tell me. And in the next step, you just add the names of people who are a part of that team. That's it. Once it is done, it'll appear here. So if I go to groups and open it, I will see something which I just created, which is CIO Power List group. Now this has members, and what we get here is not new mail now, we get new conversation. So if I say new conversation, notice what happened. That DL has already been created, and we are sending a mail to that group rather than individual members, because members keep changing and we can't keep track of that as well. Now the best part is, when I send something here, where is it going to go? Maybe there are 15 members in that group. Where is it going to go? Typically we will feel that it will go in individual 15 mailboxes. That's not the case. Only if the members go to that group and see something called conversation view, they will see this. It will not clutter their inbox. And that itself makes life simpler, because we are struggling to keep the inbox with some sanity, and this doesn't clutter it. Now, if team members are mobile, there is an app available, and we can actually chat here itself using mobile, using tablet, using whatever else. So this is a better way of communicating within the group without interfering with anyone else. What else do we get here? Let me show you. So apart from creating a conversation list, what it has created is a shared calendar. Shared calendar is only for keeping track of things happening in that group, milestones, deadlines, whatever it is. So now when I have this, this is not my individual calendar. There are 15 other people in my team. They have their own personal calendars. What happens is, this is the group calendar. And if I go to my regular calendar and look at that calendar, it'll automatically be added to my personal calendar. It takes a little while, but it works fine. So that's how calendar entries get merged without any extra effort from anybody. The next thing which it creates is a file storage for all the members. That's not OneDrive. Behind the scenes, it's a SharePoint site, but that is created here. So if I go to any group and click on it, I will see something like OneDrive, but actually it is not OneDrive. But you will get a special area where people can store files related to that team. And of course, you get a shared OneNote notebook, so people can type their minutes of meeting, research findings in single notebook, and everyone gets it synchronized. So this is a very simple thing to implement, but it dramatically changes teamwork, especially the kind of teamwork where a cross-functional team has been formed, there is a tight deadline, and everyone has to execute quickly. Today, what happens is everyone tries to send CCs to each other and confuse each other. This is much, much better. But now there is another tool because this is Outlook based. Many people don't like email based communication for teamwork. Many people like Slack kind of interface, which is chat based or discussion group based. So there is another tool available, which is called Microsoft Teams, which allows you to do same thing, but in a much more sophisticated manner. So here you create a team, and concept is exactly the same. Give a name to the team and specify members. From an end user side, they don't have to create a DL, they don't have to create the SharePoint list or nothing of that sort. Nay, I changed it. Earlier it was .biz, but nowadays many spam filters are automatically filtering out .biz, so I changed it to .co. CO is more fashionable nowadays than com. So this is a separate application, again available on mobile, and it allows you similar things, but it allows you additional stuff which groups doesn't allow. For example, it allows you a chat based, rather discussion based interface. So if I type something, this is a new conversation I'm starting. And anybody in the group will now reply. How many of you have used this before or tried it at least, pilot, anything of that sort? So the biggest problem with this is the other person who is going to see similar structure on their screen or their mobile is going to most probably type here, thinking that I'm replying to this person. Actually, the reply should be given here. When you type something here, a new discussion thread gets created and people get completely confused at the end of it. So use it carefully. Of course, we can have multiple channels. General is like for everyone in the group, and then we can have multiple topics of discussion happening. But what is most important is this. You can add related stuff here. For example, you can add all kinds of files, you can add Power BI reports, you can add all kinds of third-party applications here for which API is available. So it is much, much more evolved and more extensible than groups. So try both, whichever works for you, use. In some cases, depending on the audience in the group, you may choose groups or team. Both ways works. So as I said, this is extensible. This works in Outlook. There is a separate app. There is a mobile app for this as well. And there is Planner for tasks. So what is Planner? All this we said is conversation, OneNote notebook, file storage, and shared calendar. But finally, the team is supposed to do some work. Where are we going to track it? So that is done in something called Planner. So let me just show you the Planner. Planner is a part of Office 365, even subscribers get it. So Planner is a web-based task management system, and it gives you various kinds of buckets for tasks, so to say. Let it come up. And this is visible to all the people. So if I say CIO power list, for example, right now, there will be no task, but I can assign tasks, I can create a board. By default, there is a to-do, but I can also add more. This is another kind of task. And what is specialty about these tasks is, of course, you can do the standard stuff, but more importantly, you can assign it to more than one person. And even then, there is one more facility available, add task. And now if I go to the task, each task can have a checklist. So that task itself may have multiple items which are supposed to be executed. So it can be a task with a checklist, which makes it more granular. And all this can be seen on dynamic charts available here. Okay, next. Now coming to communication, which basically happens through email. So here is a list of when not to send an email. Have you seen this list before? There's a lot of stuff written on email etiquette, but what if you are misusing email? That is not the right channel. So let me show you what happens. Obviously, the first one is obvious, but when there is some mail comes which disturbs you, you immediately do a knee-jerk reaction. In Outlook also, there is a feature when you send a mail which says delay delivery. At least use that. Do it for tomorrow morning and morning relook at it. There is a delay delivery option which can also be used to make sure you never forget birthdays. Sit one day and send happy birthday mails to everyone and delay the delivery to that date. The only limitation is Outlook has to be open on that day. Now, one-liner mails. Very often, I ask someone on phone, can I do this? Someone says yes, and then we say, still, put it on mail. Why do we do that? Because we need an audit trail in case there is a dispute later. The same thing can now be done using Skype for Business. Why is that important? Because that saves you a mail trail, and everything which is being done on Skype for Business is also being archived and available for audit in case there is a dispute. So that's that. Other one, delegation should never be done by sending mails. It should be done using Task or Planner, which I just showed you. If any attachment is just a delivery, then use email. If it requires further interaction, then put it on OneDrive and then send the link, OneDrive or SharePoint. Now, long mail trails. Very often there is a dispute going on amongst various people. Suddenly someone adds you to the mail trail and say, now boss, you solve it. Now what do? If you reply to that mail, you are continuing to lengthen that mail trail and nobody has a clue exactly what is happening. So here is the deal. Suppose there is a mail which has come from someone, and notice, if I notice that this person whom has sent it to me is actually green. Green means available. I can actually go here itself, do a chat and find it out. In fact, that option has always been there for around 10 years. Unfortunately, it's called IM. It's not called Skype, it's not called Link, it's not called OCS. And nobody understood IM means one of those. So if I open this, I have two options, reply with IM only to the sender or reply all. What does that mean? All the people who are fighting with each other, if they're available, I'll put them in a chat right now and finish it off. If they're not available, there is another option, which is called reply with meeting, in which case all the people will be put in a meeting and then you solve it. Don't extend long mail trails. That choice is with you. And if you don't know whom to ask, you know someone in the organization will know the answer, but you don't know whom to ask, then put it on some social media, whichever you are using, Yammer, Facebook for work, or Slack, or whatever you use. So that is the list of when not to send mails. Analytics, I'm going to show you only one demo, and I strongly implore all of you to look at Power Query. 60% of time users spend in analyzing data, creating reports and MIS and whatever they do, goes in cleaning up data. Power Query is an end user ETL tool. It's phenomenal. You don't need to know any programming, and it allows you data from all kinds of data sources and allows you extensive cleanup, which you have never even imagined. And the best part is once you clean up the data, it remembers the steps. So next time if you have to do a refresh, you just say right click refresh. And the query itself can be saved on a data catalog so that if I have taken the effort, everyone in the organization will benefit from it without even lifting their finger. Now there is something called forecasting. I'm just going to show you the place where it is. And because this is a very quick demo, I'm just going to create some random data. Now, assume these were sales figures for every day. And based on this, you want to forecast for next 3, 5, whatever number of days. So what do? You go to data, and there is a new button here called forecast sheet. So click on the forecast sheet and see what it is saying. I'm just increasing the number of forecasted periods. And open this. Include forecast statistics. And just say create. I will have to add another column for date, but never mind. Just go to that button and click on it. It also supports seasonality, which is very important. Otherwise, using normal statistics, seasonality incorporation is a bit difficult. So use that tool. Okay, now presentations. I'm going to show you only one thing. You remember I did that animation of how the document was going to different people? How did that happen? There's a new functionality added in PowerPoint called Morph. What does that basically mean? If I have some shape here, if I have to move this shape, I have to put animation, and that's complicated, especially if I have multiple shapes. So what do I do now? I just make a copy of this slide, move the shape, rotate the shape, resize the shape, whatever I want to do, I do. I'll also change the color. And in the second slide, you actually apply a transition rather than an animation. And that transition is extremely powerful, just one button. What does it do? When I run the first slide, it goes from here and morphs it to the other one. So using morph feature, I created those 8 slides of the animation which showed the bad way of doing teamwork. It took me 3 minutes to do that. So wherever you are using complex animation, check whether morph can help you. And the last thing I want to show is, notice I have a presentation here. Not many slides, but I have multiple topics. You'll notice that every topic is a title kind of slide. That is presentations, teamwork, communication, file storage. Now, if it was a longer interactive session, I would have asked you, what is your interest, and go to that first. Now, I need an interactive menu for doing that. And that was difficult to do, although possible for 25 years. Nobody understood it. So now notice what happens. I go to insert and say zoom. This is not the zoom which I am using to zoom the screen. This is a very different type of zoom. And I choose summary zoom. And now what do? I choose only the topics which I want. So this is the title, obviously I'll choose it. And then I'll choose teamwork. And then I'll choose communication, analytics, and PowerPoint presentation. That's it. And then you click OK. So what happened? It added a new slide here with all the thumbnails automatically. And now if I want to directly go to analytics and show you something, it's going to show you all the slides under analytics and come back to this menu. Then I go to presentation, present it, show it, come back, and that's it. Thank you.